Comrades, I'm going to
stutter my way through a short introduction. I realise that in the joys of the celebrations and festivities and dancing yesterday, we didn't get to thank our sponsors, and so I would like to thank the Academy. And the Lila Spencer Latin American Studies and Collections, the Institute for Historical Studies, the Latin American Initiative at Texas Law, Edible Austin, and the Lyndon Baines Johnson School of Public Affairs. Now, I'm particularly grateful for the Lyndon Baines Johnson School of Public Affairs because the Dean, Angela Evans, is here to introduce this panel. And so my pleasure is to introduce her. Now, Angela has been in public service, and in fact working in the US Congress for 40 years, the last 13 of which were as Deputy Director of the Congressional Research Service. Angela is now transforming the LBJ School into even more of a sort of an institution that brings together the academy and the world beyond it. She's made it possible, for example, for myself and my colleague Erin Lentz, also at the Lyndon Baines Johnson School of Public Affairs. We were able to serve the city of Austin with 12 incredible graduate students to figure out food insecurity in Austin. And unfortunately, the data we found was that 25% of households in this city are food insecure, which is far higher in a foodie city than anyone was comfortable with. But what we also found by following the kinds of practices that Umberto was sharing with us yesterday is that people have ideas about how to transform that. And it's indicative of the kind of work that Angela makes possible at the LBJ School to bring together the voices of citizens with great ideas and the resources and expertise that we have at this university. So Angela, thank you so much for your work there, and thank you so much for making this conference possible. And ladies and gentlemen, Dean Angela Evans.
I have two mics. Which one do I
use? I'm going to, well, you, yeah.
As long as one doesn't interfere with the other. Hi, everybody. So it was a beautiful day outside, and you all had lunch, and you're all back, and we were just talking about the importance of food, right? I really am pleased to be one of the sponsors of this important conference for two reasons. One is that the LBJ legacy is built on Mr. Johnson's devotion, his hard work, and his stamina in bringing in food programs to the United States of America through his democratic process and through Congress. And the second is, I think as the school enters it's almost 50 years old, so as the school enters its next half of a century of birthday, it's really important that the school reach out and think about ourselves as global partners to all of you who are dealing with very similar problems around the world. So we're all really one. We're all really one big family working on this. And when you think about all the important things that we do in our lives, we think about the environment, very important that we have a safe and clean environment, but you think about people and the ability of them to have access, not only access, but also quality. So they have access to food and quality of that food. So this is extremely important, and I don't want to overstate it, you know, to the human race and to our ability to work together and to find peaceful solutions to things. Because when you're hungry and you're desperate, you're in a difficult place and you're under duress. So I'm really, really pleased to be here. I'm so glad that Raj is with us. We have a lot of great faculty at our school, and I'm very pleased that we have this very illustrious and very informative panel for you today. Miguel Altieri and Hannah Whitman, and Marla is going to moderate this panel for us. If you all are on campus, come see us at the LBJ School. We're happy to see you. If you're faculty, get in touch with us. We'd love to work with you. So I'm very pleased to be here, and it's an honor to introduce Marla and introduce the panel. Thank you so much.
All right, thank you everyone for being here. It is my pleasure to introduce the speakers for this second panel of the day. I'm gonna start with Hannah Whitman. Dr. Whitman has her bachelor's degree in international and environmental studies from the University of Washington, and her master's and PhD in development sociology from Cornell University. Her research examines the ways that the right to produce and consume food are contested and transformed through struggles for agrarian reform, food sovereignty and agrarian citizenship. Her projects include community-based research on farmland access, transition to organic agriculture, and seed sovereignty in British Columbia, agroecological transition, and the role of institutional procurement in the transition of food sovereignty in Ecuador and Brazil, and the role that urban agriculture and farm-to-school nutrition initiatives play in food sovereignty education, in food literacy education, sorry. She is the academic director of the Center for Sustainable Food Systems and associate professor in the Institute for Resources, Environment, and Sustainability at the University of British Columbia. Please, let's give a warm applause to our presenter. And so our second speaker is Miguel Altieri. Miguel Altieri received a Bachelor in Agronomy from the University of Chile and a PhD in Entomology from the University of Florida. He has been a professor of agroecology at UC Berkeley since 1981 in the Department of Environmental Science, Policy, and Management. Dr. Altieri served as a scientific advisor to the Latin American Consortium on Agroecology and Development. He also served for 4 years as a general coordinator to the United Nations Development Program Sustainable Agriculture Networking and Extension Program. In addition, he was the chairman of the NGO committee of the Consultative Group on International Agriculture Research. He was also the director of the U.S.-Brazil Consortium on Agroecology and Sustainable Rural Development, an academic research exchange program involving students and faculty of UC Berkeley, University of Nebraska, UNICAMP, and Universidad Federal de Santa Catarina. Currently, he is advisor to the FAO-GIAS program, a program devoted at identifying and dynamically conserving traditional farming systems in the developing world. He also served for 6 years as the president of Latin American Scientific Society of Agroecology. He's the author of more than 230 publications and numerous other books. So please, let's give a warm welcome to Miguel Altieri. And so the name of our panel is Agroecological Perspectives, Sustainability and Action. And we are going to start with Miguel.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry I cannot sit down. I'm half Italian, half Chilean, so no way. So thanks a lot for the invitation. And what I wanted to do is to kind of go through with examples through the history of agroecology in Latin America. But before that, it is important to understand why it emerged. As you know, those that were interested in promoting rural development and agricultural development in Latin America were foreigners that came with this Malthusian idea that the problem of hunger was explained by the fact that population growth was growing exponentially and food production was not catching up, and that therefore we needed to bring technologies from developed countries in order to close the gap. And what happened is that throughout the years, there had been several agricultural revolutions in Latin America. Perhaps the most important one is the Green Revolution that brought, you know, hybrid varieties, the improved varieties with the technological package, and the last one is biotechnology. So what happened was that Ford, Kellogg, Rockefeller Foundations created some centers. They wanted to modernize Latin American agriculture. And the first center that they created was CIMIT, which is the corn and wheat center in Mexico, who is still there. And then they created these research stations that were, this one is in Texcoco. And as you can see, the idea was to set up experiment stations where where researchers would be trying these varieties, these modern varieties. And then in the back here, La Purificación is a little community of farmers that still exist that were practicing something totally different than this, what I call innocents abroad were doing, you know, in the agricultural experiment stations. There were very well-intentioned scientists from the donor countries, like from the United States, from Canada, from Europe, from Australia. They had never been in the tropics, but they wanted to help. And what happened was that, obviously, they ignored the knowledge of these farmers, and more so, they ignored this knowledge of the Chinampas, which are Aztec systems that have been there for 5,000 years. And the reason why they ignored it is because they thought that this knowledge was product of ignorance. And they also ignored the typical systems that were growing in the Chinampas, like the milpas, where actually the milpas back in 1950, when the Green Revolution started, they were producing up to 6.3 tons per hectare of corn, whereas in the US, they were producing 4 tons. So the idea was, who's gonna teach to grow corn to whom? And 1 hectare of chinampas could produce enough food for 15 to 20 people, because they not only grew corn, they grew fish, they grew fruits, etc. Interestingly enough, when the Green Revolution started, before the Green Revolution started, Rockefeller hired Professor Sauer from Berkeley, who was a geographer, who came down. They brought him because he had worked with native agriculture in Mexico, so kind of a guide of this bunch of agronomists from Iowa, Ohio, Cornell, all these places. And he wrote a minority report when he came back and said, a good aggressive bunch of American agronomists and plant breeders could ruin the native resources for good and all by pushing their American commercial stocks. And Mexican agriculture cannot be pointed towards standardization on a few commercial types without upsetting native economy and culture hopelessly. The example of Iowa is about the most dangerous of all for Mexico. Unless the Americans understand that, they better keep out of this country entirely. Of course, they kicked them out of the committee. The Green Revolution proceeded. They created more centers, this one's in Colombia and Cali, for beans and cassava, again, full of innocents abroad. And in these flat soils, they developed the varieties that they expected that would work here, you know, where the small farmers live in marginal environments, you know, no access to market, no access to capital, no access to technology. And no wonder then is that the Green Revolution benefited the more resource-endowed farmers rather than the peasants. Actually, the peasants, this is in Mexico, only adopted, 12% of the peasants adopted the high-yielding varieties. And then they try to figure out why they were not adopting them. And that time, they brought sociologists and anthropologists into the center, and they created the farming systems to try to figure out why they are not adopting. It's not, you know, to understand the ecological rationale, the cultural rationale. They wanted to figure it out, hey, you guys figured out how we can push these varieties anyway on them. So that was the role of rural sociologists at that time. Well, the Malthusian approach continued, and now we have the second revolution, which has not benefited peasants at all, because actually it's all for large-scale soybean production in Brazil, Argentina, Paraguay, Bolivia, etc. So in conclusion, six decades of Green Revolution did not help. The social and ecological toll has been equally enormous and have outstripped the benefits. Whoever wants to argue in favor of the Green Revolution needs to counteract with the cultural, ecological, social impacts, and focus instead on the root causes of rural problems and hunger, abandoning the agricultural models incapable of ensuring respect for the poor and the environment. This is what we need. So what are the challenges that we're facing in the region and globally is that we need to increase food production, not double it, like, you know, Gates Foundation says. I don't know where they got that information. It's a necessary condition, but not sufficient condition. But the problem is that it's going to be the same or less arable land, less petroleum, less water in a climate change scenario, social unrest, financial crisis, etc. And what the agroecological movement says that this challenge cannot be met with the existing model, and what we need is an alternative, which is agroecology. But this has an ethics also, that first of all, it needs to incorporate the fundamental rights of the poor or the right to food. Second, it must challenge the right of private property as an absolute and inviolable right, and stress the social purpose of all forms of private property, what we call the social function of the land. Okay, so the access to land is a fundamental issue that we need to address, obviously, within this agroecological paradigm. So what we're talking about is a new agriculture that is going to be decoupled from fossil fuel dependence, has to be friendly to the environment, resilient to climate change, multifunctional, not only that it produces food, but many other services, like maintaining cultural identity, and it has to provide the basis for local food systems. So what we're really talking about is an agriculture that, within those models, is that this agriculture that is going to have high diversity, high productivity, high levels of efficiency that come from about the design of the systems based on agroecological principles that doesn't depend on external inputs. It basically increases the recycling rates and the integration between crops and animals. The ecological interactions between the components of the system are the ones that drive the ecological processes in the system. So when you ask yourself, do these systems exist? Well, yeah. Peasants have been doing this for centuries in the Andean region and the Mesoamerica, where they have developed these systems. And data from different sources shows that actually there's about 1.5 billion peasants worldwide that produce between 50 and 75% of the food. Actually, industrial agriculture only produces 30% of the food, but occupies 80% of the land. And only this productivity comes using 30% of the water and only 20% of the fossil fuels. Now, when you look at Latin America, you'll find that that's the case. If you go to Brazil, you go to Chile, Ecuador, Cuba, most of the peasants are the ones that are producing the food, not the large-scale commercial sector, which is actually involved in export agriculture, and many of them producing biofuels. So agroecology then emerged as this science that benefits from a dialogue of wisdom. So on the one side, the traditional knowledge of farmers, on the other side, some contributions of Western science, including the social sciences. And what is derived from this is principles. Principles that take different technological forms. It's very different from organic farming that works with recipes and practices. The practices are the result of applying the principles of agroecology. So at the beginning, agroecology, this conception, was taken by, I'm talking about in the 1980s, by NGOs, nonprofit organizations that were working with funding from international donors, especially from Europe and the church. And the idea was that respecting this traditional knowledge of farmers, there could be some kind of a blending in a participatory way to deal with the problems that peasants are facing today because climate is changing, new pests have arrived. That must be Monsanto. Calling. So, interestingly enough, there was a lot of interesting work done in the Andes, for example, in Puno region of at 3,500 meters above sea level, to reconstruct traditional systems called the Waruwarus, which actually are systems that existed and now, through food for work, have been reconstructed, about 140 hectares in that region, which allows these crops, quinoa, amaranthus, potatoes, etc., to grow in the midst of frost because the water absorbs the heat during the day, changes the microclimate. There was a lot of work and still going on reconstructing terraces in the, where many of them were abandoned, which actually have shown tremendous microclimatic advantages, water conservation, and increased yields. A lot of work in the recovery of traditional varieties, like Humberto was talking about yesterday, for example. This is work in Chiloé Island, which is a secondary center of origin of potatoes, where these women, called the Huilliche Indians, have preserved many, many varieties, and then they have taught the local peasants that lost those varieties how to grow them in community seed banks. And then the seed banks allows the families then to take the varieties that they need to start reintroducing the genetic diversity that they had lost. And much of this exchange happens in the Andes, for example, or in Mexico, through the seed fairs, where farmers come, and then they exchange seeds, and then next year they meet again. It's one way, one mechanism. There are many other ways. Facing the hillsides where in Central America a lot of farmers live, there was very important work done by world neighbors where they started trying to promote soil conservation practices with the use of mucuna, which is a legume that acts as a mulch but also as a cover crop. And then you incorporate it into the soil, has a cover, increases organic matter, and so on. And you can see the results here in terms of the fixing of nitrogen, how many families just in Honduras benefited at that point, and how you were able to almost quadruple the yields, quadruplicar the yields of corn under these conditions. That's a really technological breakthrough. And on top of that, the work that Eric Hall Jimenez did later showed that these systems that were adopting these systems resisted the hurricane Mitch much better than the ones that didn't. This is what happened with the monocultures that were not adopting these practices. Now, an emblematic agroecological event happened in Latin America, and Humberto was talking about, was when, and he showed the statistics already of what happened when the Soviet bloc collapsed and the Cuban agriculture that was totally dependent on the help of the Soviet bloc had to deal with the fact that there was a tremendous reduction in the imports of pesticides, fertilizers, and so on. Interestingly enough, there were scientists working on biological control, on soil management, et cetera. But also, there was a very strong peasant movement. And if you look at the data of Peter Rosset and other people, this shows that this is the contribution of peasants for different crops. This is before the special period, when there were fertilizers and pesticides. And this is after the special period, when there's no pesticides and fertilizers. The ones that came up to the plate, how you say, came up to the plate, were the peasants. And this has happened in many other parts of the world, too. So there were a lot of innovations that are still going on in Cuba, although there's big changes that are happening that we can discuss, too. And the ANAP, which is the Asociación Nacional de Agricultores Pequeños, the Small Farmers Organization, promoted through farmer-to-farmer networks, campesino-campesino, a lot of these methodologies to start increasing the production of these systems. And one of them is Casimiro, which actually Humberto knows. He was a policeman, but he went back to the land, and this is with his son when they arrived, and then this is what happened after they transformed it with agroecological design. And it's very important here to see not only the different systems that they have in terms of rotations of crops and pasture, silvopastoral system, agroforestry system, but this network of hedgerows that are multiple use, but they play a very important role in climate change resiliency. Well, Fernandito Funes, who is an agroecologist in Cuba, has done studies of this farm, and he showed that Casimiro can feed 34 persons with protein producing 1 hectare. That's 340 people with 10 hectares. But the most important thing is with an energy efficiency of 30. He puts 1 kilocalorie, he gets 30 back. Very much, you know, correcting what, well, not correcting, but showing that it's possible to have a diet based on sun energy rather than petroleum, as Raj was saying yesterday. So this network of hedgerows plus agroforestry systems have played a huge role in protecting the systems against climate change. Remember that Cuba didn't have anything to do with producing climate change. I mean, there are the producers and the recipients. The producers are the US and Canada and Europe and China. Latin America is the recipient of all this stuff, especially the peasants. And they did a study in Santi Spiritu in a cooperative. These are the mean, 72% loss. And the most diversified farms suffered less. It was a pretty bad hurricane, about 60%. But what's interesting is the rate of recovery, because resiliency is not only is the resistance to the impact, but also the capacity to recover. So you can see here that these farms that are the farms that are more diversified recover much quicker than these farms that were the monoculture ones. And this is only 60 days after. Now, when you say, how do they recover? For example, this is another farm called La Perla after Michel. What happens is that if you have a monoculture, your trees will be blown away with roots and everything. If you have hedgerows or agroforestry, your trees will fall down, but the roots will be still connected to the soil. So all you have to do is stand them up again and put some rocks and some soil again, and it will work. The Green Revolution also reached the livestock sector by promoting these grasslands of tropical grasslands with improved grasses of high productivity. They work really well if you have water and fertilizer. What happened is that the drought came. Thousands and thousands of cows died. This is in Colombia. But except these systems, which are the silvopastoral system that have been developed by an NGO called CIPAV. And I don't have time to go into why these systems are more resilient. But all you can see is that in one of these farms, this is milk production in the agroforestry system, despite of the rainfall. It doesn't matter whether it's Niña, Niño. is constant. In the farms that are monocultures that dry, the one that I show you, production of milk went down. So there has been a lot of work in developing integrated farms. This is work that was done by Instituto Pasto y Forrajes back in the 90s in Cuba, where there was designs of 50% crops, 50% livestock. What is really interesting here is the data. As you can see, after 3 years of conversion, because in agroecology, when you apply the principles, what you have to do is install first what we call the ecological infrastructure, the hedgerows, the rotations. You have to divide the field in plots that are going to have probably some living fences and things of that nature. There's a lot of work that needs to be done. So you can see that, for example, here, the production started going up. The protein produced went up, the energy, the amount of people from 4 to 5. But look at what happens with human labor. It goes down. So these people that think that it's not a bad idea that you have to more work with agriculture because, you know, there's a lot of unemployed people out there. But it actually, if you have the design already in place, your labor needs go down, not up. And the same thing happens with the tractor energy. So at the end, what you find is that these farms, that when the natural capital starts working, your financial capital needs go down. We also saw this in a farm that we established back in the 1980s in the midst of the dictatorship in Chile. The question that we had was, can a family of 5 feed themselves with 1 acre of land? So we did a design that I don't have time to go into it again because of the time. But I just wanted to emphasize the data that we obtained from this half hectare right after, 3 years after. And you can see that, first of all, the rotation produced three tons of food. This is 3 years after the infrastructure was established. The home garden by the house, 1 ton. Fruits, about 1 ton, etc. Well, 1 family of 5 cannot eat all this. You know, you're not going to eat 2,500 eggs. So actually, there is the possibility of selling the surplus and generating income. So what happens is that these people, first of all, save in production costs because the cost of production goes down. Second, they don't buy food because they produce everything that they eat. Third, they're in better condition to negotiate their terms of reference with the market and with the labor, because many of these peasants, what they do, they work to pick fruits for the rich, you know, fruit companies. But if they pay me a dollar, they say, no, I won't work for you because, again, here we go, because I'm already food sovereign. Okay, so food sovereignty empowers farmers in the sense that they can accept to work, be exploited or not. The other thing that somebody mentioned today is the fact that by the year 2030, actually, that's when most of the population, about 75% of the world population, is going to live in cities. And the cities of more than 10 million people are going to triple. So it is estimated that cities of 10 million people require 6,000 tons of food per day to be imported that travel about 1,000 miles on average. Well, that's not sustainable, obviously. So what is the solution? The solution is to continue promoting and supporting small farmers, but also promoting urban agriculture, which actually is a phenomenon that is happening even in the United States, in Canada, and different places. But not at the scale as in Cuba, where actually the latest statistics that I got recently from the people there in INIFAD is that there's about 50,000 hectares in the island, and the productivity ranges between 10 and 20 kilos per square meter. Actually, you can produce 20 kilos of food per year if you do the right rotation, the right associations of crops in those systems. Now, as I mentioned yesterday, when I was asking a question to Humberto, is that much of this was designed for improving the food security of the island, but because of the market now, the tourists, much of this stuff is going to the tourist market because it's the one that is offering to pay a good price for this food. So that's a dilemma that needs to be somehow worked out. Now, agroecology is also now going at a bigger scale. The Via Campesina and other movements are talking about territorios agroecológicos, that is, the control of territories via different ways, occupation like MST, or land reform or other mechanisms. And these territories are places of resistance against the aggressions that are coming from the industrial model, all the way from the transgenic crops, the plantations, the agrofuels, the land grabbing that is going on is one way, mining, another huge process that is going on in rural areas of Latin America. And there's very interesting examples. For example, some farmers, this is in La Mixteca, in the highlands of Mexico. What is the destiny of these farmers? If they leave, they go to the norte, or they go to Mexico City, you know what the fate is. So these farmers here decided to stay. But in order to stay, you have to do an ecological restoration of those landscapes. So there's very interesting work in reforestation, in the top of the mountain, soil conservation practices, including water harvesting, which allows then the farmers, depending on the amount of water that they harvest, to reintroduce some of their crops, like amaranthus, very rich in protein, and iron and vitamin A and so on, and corn. So see, this is a farmer that is benefiting from those works. If you go to Colombia, for example, in a region called El Dovio, this is what happened in 1992. The peasants started organizing, reforesting. This is now the watershed. Why is this important? Because before, in 1993, there was only enough water for 25 families. Today, there's enough water for 75 families. And there's all kinds of other indicators that are showing that the recovery with ecological restoration of these landscapes is fundamental for creating a matrix for agriculture to function in a good way. This is another sample from Las Tunas, allá en tu isla, en la isla. These people benefited from a decree called Decree 300, which is people can have access to land in the peri-urban areas up to, I think it's 13 hectares, but I think it's higher than that. Well, anyway, this guy acquired the land and started an agroecological design, as you can see here. They restored that area with a lot of work. And then, Monsanto. Jesus Christ. Okay. Send, don't send.
Don't send.
See if it comes back. Yeah, okay. Where were we? This is like a semester class, but in 20 minutes. I just wanted to show you the levels of production. This is the average of the provincia, and this is look at the values of the reconverted farm for all the different crops. If you go to the northeast of Brazil, you'll find, for example, very interesting work. This is very much similar to the work that Humberto was talking about. Seed banks, community seed banks, exchanges, networks, farmers exchanging seeds. More than 16,000 kilos have been exchanged in that particular community of varieties that are adapted to the dry conditions. Then you have to reforest with native varieties. ¿Cuánto tiempo? Cinque minuti. Water harvesting also. Anyway, so in conclusion, what's happening is agroecology, as opposed to what many agrarian, we call it campesinistas, that predicted the disappearing of the peasantry. Actually, there is a recampesinización going on, repesantization. First of all, through agroecology, by revitalizing small farms, because farmers, agroecology moves peasants from to autonomy, from inputs, from the market, from debt, and by recovering and restoring territories. That's the other way in which representation is happening. So social movements like Via Campesina, MSST, many of them have adopted agroecology as a very important pillar of their food sovereignty proposal. Actually, it's one of the main pillars, as agroecology, as well as social movements, state support, access to land. Why is agroecology then so compatible with the social movements? Well, there's a lot of reasons. One of them is that it doesn't change one knowledge for another, but basically respects and mobilizes traditional knowledge, is participatory, is ecologically sound, is economically viable. And if you look at the declaration of the Via Campesina in Mali, they have now adopted a much more militant view of agroecology, which actually in academia they don't want to even talk about it. But they see it as a key form of resistance, and they see it as a way to get out of the collective crisis that is affecting them. So what social movements have done, in addition to this process, is they have pressured governments to create legislature, laws. Brazil, Guatemala, actually in Brazil, there was a law, a national law of agroecology. In Uruguay, it's about to be approved. But this law now is not working, because now you have a new government, you know, that is right-wing and that's not going to impose it. So you cannot depend on just policy change. I see too much emphasis on policy change. Actually, it depends on who is governing. What we need to create is perhaps more what another rural sociologist, Van der Ploeg, talks about. He says that the food empires are controlling the food system, determining what farmers are going to grow, how much, for whom, what consumers are going to eat, how much they're going to pay. They have strangled the food system. So what he's talking about is the creating a bypass that works within the capitalist system, but it's not subjected to the capitalist rules. Because there's a lot of farmers market that we could say is part of the bypass. Yeah, but in California, they're all for the elite. You know, you don't find Afro-Americans or Latinos buying in farmers market, organic farmers market. Forget it. I don't buy there. It's too expensive. So what we're talking about is how we're going to democratize the food system through this bypass. This is the big challenge. And also, we need to think about how we're going to scale up agroecology, not depending so much on, you know, enabling public policies, supporting farmers' networks. This part of unlocking ideological barriers is very important, because right now there's a co-option of agroecology by the international organizations, FAO and so on. And the funding is also interesting. There's an agroecological fund here in the United States. It's called the Agroecology Fund, a bunch of foundations. By invitation only. Actually, they have never invited SOCLA, which is the largest Latin American network on agroecology. Why not? I mean, if you're going to fund agroecology, you better fund the people that have been doing it historically. But you also need social organization, horizontal social processes, peasant protagonism, leaders. This is very important, and so on and so on. So with that, I just wanted to finish. Un minuto. Thank you.
These are going to be very compatible talks, I think. Great. So I am a rural sociologist, hopefully one of those different kind. And I have been working in the area of food sovereignty and agrarian reform for quite a while. And what I want to talk about today is how do we get there? How do you take these big concepts like food sovereignty or these very diverse practices related to agroecology and address this confluence and crisis that we see in the world? So we have food insecurity, and you know, even in Canada, we have 1 in 7 or 1 in 8 people are hungry every day. Food prices are rising and are extremely volatile, which affects particularly urban people who don't have the ability to grow their own food and kind of protect or be resilient against that kind of volatility. We have farmland speculation, so even farmers who are accessing land are being pushed off and evicted by international capital, which is trying to take advantage of this food price volatility. And then finally, as we all know, agriculture can contribute up to 30% of greenhouse gas emissions. And so, you know, farmers have a responsibility and kind of a unique opportunity to help address climate change resilience. So where do you come into it? I was really happy to see Lourdes had the more complex version of this slide. Where do you enter into this food system with different policies or ideas? Where, you know, how do you see food sovereignty in all of the different aspects of our food system? Well, there's a lot of suggested solutions out there. We can, you know, talk about the agricultural intensification, more crop per drop, GMOs, all those kinds of things which are getting heavily invested in. We can, you know, distribute food more efficiently. We talk about there's definitely more than enough calories in the world for everyone to eat a healthy diet now, but a lot of that's going to animals, a lot of that's, you know, maybe we should have more efficient trade. So the food sovereignty movement pushes back against that quite strongly. We could decrease food waste. We could eat more ugly vegetables. We could bring marginal areas into production. We could have more urban farms. We could change our consumption habits. We could have more vegans. Or we could do all of those things in different capacities. And when we talk about different trade deals, we could just have different trade deals. How do you enact food sovereignty in agroecological food systems? So I want to just take a step back and define what we mean by food sovereignty. Food sovereignty is a concept that came about in the early 1990s, kind of stemming from years of Latin American mobilization around the idea of sovereignty and the idea of food sovereignty, which was really coming up through Central American agrarian movements. This resonated with agrarian movements from across the world, including Europe, including Canada, including South America, with the Latin American Conference of Peasant Movements, who said we need an alternative to this idea of food security as just moving food from one place to the other. We need a concept that really represents agrarian people's both rights to the land and their abilities to provide for food security and nutrition to their communities. And so they formed a social movement called the Via Campesina, or the Peasant Way, which argued for this right to food sovereignty as the right of peoples, all peoples, not just farmers, to healthy and culturally appropriate food produced through ecologically sound methods. So it's kind of riffing on food security, but saying, but we don't care just about having enough food, we care about how food is produced and where it is produced. And by that manner, they say, you know, to get to food sovereignty, we need to think about giving priority to local and natural cultures, local and national cultures, economies, and markets. And so this slogan, get the WTO out of agriculture, became really emblematic of the birth of the food sovereignty movement, because they saw these international trade deals as taking away the rights of local people to manage their own territories and to manage their own food security struggles. So this movement has moved all over the world. There's about more than 250 million family farms that are involved in the movement. I think about 79 countries have representatives. This is not an NGO movement. These are movements of farmers, indigenous peoples, and fisher folk who are people working the land. So the Via Campesina made a very strategic decision at that time to say we're not going to be subject to conflict of interest. We talked this morning about conflict of interest and the way in which the interests of the industrial food system have often filtered through governments and have filtered through the NGO sector. And so there may be alliances in certain cases and in certain initiatives with NGOs or government agencies. The Via Campesina is absolutely a grassroots and peasant-led movement. So what are the principles that kind of bring all of these people together from many different countries, many different context, really? I mean, what brings together a wheat farmer from Canada with a landless peasant from Brazil, from a Cuban urban farmer? Well, distributive justice, so who gets what? Ecological sustainability, how is food produced and with what effect to the environment around us? And then procedural justice. How are rights enacted on the land? How are rights protected, and how are the courts structured to enable one kind of food production system over another? And we like to say that there's kind of the three E's of the food sovereignty movement. We care about equity, we care about ecology, and we care about empowerment. And those are things that actually urban people care about too. So one of the interesting things that's been happening with the food sovereignty movement is seeing how urban people who really resonate with these principles say, you know, I can get involved in the food sovereignty movement as an urban person by working for food equity in urban centers. I can work for environmental regulation of industrial agriculture. I can work to empower food choices. So whether that's through food literacy or providing access to more options or, you know, different interventions in the food system that can happen. It's not just about growing food anymore. It's about how do you integrate into the food system, whether you're a consumer or a producer or a fisher folk or an indigenous person in your traditional territory. So how do we get there? Some of the research that I work on, and this policy question is a tricky one, because when you start to go down the policy road, as we've heard about this morning and as we've seen with agricultural policy for since the Green Revolution and prior, there's trade-offs and concessions that often get made. And so some of my more recent projects have started to look at the policy initiatives that have emerged around food sovereignty, many of those pushed by food sovereignty movements, and then seeing how they're working out on the ground. I just wanted to share that this is happening not just in Latin America. The Canadian food sovereignty movement has been pushing for a national food strategy or national food plan in Canada. We do not have one, and they're actually using food sovereignty principles to put that forward. So that's not yet a policy, but these are, again, an example of citizens groups using food sovereignty principles to advocate for particular kinds of policies. So the Canadian food sovereignty movement is advocating for a national school food school lunch program. We're the only G8 country that does not have a federally funded national school lunch program. So in Ecuador is one of the several countries that now recognize the right to food sovereignty in their constitution. So in 2008, as part of a much broader constitutional assembly process and the creation of a new constitution that also gave rights to nature, the Ecuadorian government, or the constitutional assembly, rather, stated that there are quite a few provisions in the constitution that are relevant to food sovereignty, but they very explicitly state persons and community groups have the right to safe and permanent access to healthy and sufficient and nutritional food. So this is kind of resonating back with original food security definitions internationally. But then they add, preferably produced locally and in keeping with their various identities and cultural traditions. So Ecuador recognizes the multicultural nature of their citizenry and says, you know, we're not recognizing the predominance of one model over another. We're looking for a diverse food system. And to do that, the Ecuadorian state shall promote food sovereignty. Brazil has not recognized food sovereignty in its constitution, but in 2010 it did amend the constitution to recognize the right to food, and there's been several other legislative policies and decrees that both in regards to agroecology and to food sovereignty, and just one example is a decree that came about right after the amendment of the constitution recognizing the right to food, where it says that the Brazilian state shall promote sustainable agroecological systems for producing and distributing food. Those systems should respect biodiversity and strengthen family agriculture, indigenous peoples, and traditional communities. They should ensure that the consumption and access to adequate and healthy food respects the diversity of national food cultures, and that they should incorporate into state policy respect for food sovereignty. So you start to see this language, which has been kind of pushed up from below for at this point in Brazil, several decades. So this came about when you saw the MST, which was the Brazilian Landless Workers Movement, which was started in 1984, one of the founders of the Via Campesina, at that point still a very rural and agrarian-based movement, in the late 1990s and into the early 2000s, started making coalitions with public health and nutrition advocacy groups and started creating a national council on food and nutritional security, where they saw again the need to bring together the interests of producers and consumers. It was really at that point that this conversation started happening at a policy and legislative network. So getting urban people involved was really, really important for the institutionalization of these principles. That said, this looks like a big victory. So then what? You know, putting it on paper, having a policy decree or even a law. Another relevant one that I will mention here, in 2009, Brazil's had a national school lunch program since the late 1950s. And in 2009, a law was passed, which is, it's not a program, actually. You'd have to legislatively undo it, that says that 30% of school food should be purchased from local, small-scale, and family farmers. And that if that production is certified agroecological or organic, including production that's certified in a community certification system, so not just, you know, industrial labeling processes, that you can get a 30% price premium for that. So there are very practical implications of these policies on the ground, which we'll get into a little bit how they've been working. So some of our colleagues at Berkeley actually have reminded us that sovereignty is not an extraneously existing object, but a living process. You know, how is this working out on the ground? How does food sovereignty foreground the conscientious building and maintaining of relationships between people, institutions, technologies, ecosystems, and landscapes across multiple scales? So when we talk about concepts like food sovereignty and agroecology, it's easy just to kind of think of them as a thing out there that can be implemented or that can be adopted. But it's really important to look at those relationships in each particular place and how they intersect with not just the local political and ecological dynamics, but the vertical dynamics of the global food system. So that's kind of the overview piece of my talk. I'm going to dig down now into a couple projects that my students and I are working on in Ecuador and Brazil to kind of think about how do these policy directions for food sovereignty and agroecology work out on the ground. And one of them that you see in a number of countries now is this idea of the power of the state to structure markets. And this is worth kind of a little digression. The food sovereignty movement, I think, has gotten a bad rap for being anti-trade because of the history of its birth in protest and resistance to the actions of the WTO and to the WTO Agreement on Agriculture and the way that those agreements dismantled state support for local agricultural systems. And because that dismantling happened in the context of a trade agreement, it's been perceived that the food sovereignty movement is anti-trade. It's about everybody producing their own food for themselves. But if you think about agriculture having been domesticated for 10,000 years, people have always traded food. They have traded food with each other, they have traded food within communities, and then they've traded food from the rural areas to the cities. The question is who governs that trade and what set of social and ecological relationships make that trade fair and sustainable. And so the social economy is an idea that rather than the purpose of trade being profit, the purpose of trade is social reproduction. It's actually feeding people in the city, it's replenishing the land with, you know, compost, and we can talk about the metabolic rift and all of those things. But when we think about the market and the economy, it doesn't have to be the neoliberal economy. It can be, you know, it can be all of these other things. And this is an image that started out from a community NGO somewhere in the States and was popularized by J.K. Gibson Graham in their book on post-capitalist economies and has been adapted further. And I just show this as an example of, you know, the visible parts of the economy. We often see, we talk about capitalist markets and wage labor, but there's all these other economic relationships that people are involved in every day, whether it's bartering or community gardens or community currencies or all of these things. And so if we think about what kind of trade and what kind of market arrangements are consistent with food sovereignty and agroecological principles of kind of resilience and that sort of thing, how could we maybe see about trying to support those kinds of economic relationships instead? So we've kind of been exploring what's out there, what are people doing, and in Ecuador, two programs that have gotten some attention are Fair Trade Bananas would be one example, and then the school meal program, which stems from, you know, coming back to the legislative piece of food sovereignty is something that's come back around from the Ecuadorian constitution. And I contrast these two because fair trade bananas aren't a state-driven policy. They're a voluntary kind of market and consumer arrangement where northern consumers of bananas, i.e. my children, are willing to pay a very tiny price premium with the idea that maybe we're supporting a more sustainable production system. And then the students that we're working with, and we're working with a group of environmental health faculty at the University Simón Bolívar in Ecuador, who are interested in the environmental health impacts of the industrial banana system, and they're looking to understand, well, how does the fair trade system fare? So this is an organization that brings together about 300 farmers in the south of Ecuador, and they're working on agroforestry systems, fair trade banana, fair trade chocolate, and then what they call their food sovereignty program, which is actually trying to diversify those farms even further into home gardens. And that project's been very interesting because there's a lot of, you know, German-funded posters in everyone's homes and a lot of sort of trying to say, well, you should maybe grow fewer bananas. There's a lot of you shoulds in this program coming from external partners to the project. And in interviewing these families, a lot of them really struggle. We interviewed a lot of families who have left the group and have gone back to conventional banana production. We've talked to a lot of people who say, well, it's just input substitution. You know, instead of spraying a chemical that's synthetic, I'm spraying a chemical that's organic. And so they're really questioning, well, what is the actual production system that would enable them to have a livelihood and, you know, address their labor. So labor is a big issue for this group. They don't have the infrastructure that Miguel talked about already set up to make this a profitable system. So that's a big challenge. Another challenge is that they say there's no local market for our produce. And again, this is a chicken and an egg problem. If there's no local market, well, why is there no local market? That's because the market infrastructure has been oriented towards kind of the industrial food system. And so it's very difficult for these farmers to get their produce to a local market. It's much easier to sell to a multinational, even if it's fair trade, banana importer who has a very kind of regimented and easy to access system to deliver bananas. So when we talk about infrastructure, it's not just the ecological infrastructure for agroecology, but it's also the marketing infrastructure that it will enable people to actually get a diversified set of products to market. And so you see kind of coming along behind some initiatives to create producer marketing cooperatives for other products to produce, to sell locally. They're starting to open kind of their own stores in town, but those are all really incipient challenges to what in the end becomes a very monocultural landscape. Even if some of this is fair trade, at the landscape level, it's still a lot of bananas. Moving on to the school food system. So a lot of these farmers are saying, well, if we can start to access this public provision program, which by law says that some of the school food budget needs to be oriented to small scale and agroecological farming systems. They say, well, maybe if we can access this guaranteed market system, we'd have a place to send our more agroecological production. So we moved on to kind of a new project to say, well, how's that working out? And so visited some just lovely agroecological farms. This is now up in the north, or the kind of the highlands just northeast of Quito, where they have agroecological producer groups who are producing diversified vegetable systems, and they're really wanting to sell to these schools. They're mainly at this point selling to wealthy people in Quito. So they're doing a CSA, they're kind of going into farmers markets, and they're moving kind of into the elite food system like what you see here. And they say, well, we actually would prefer that our food is going to feed our children in these school programs, but we're having trouble getting the food again through that marketing infrastructure. So then we went and visited the community kitchens that are making the food for the schools. And as it turns out, schools used to produce their own food. And they used to cook their own food, and they used to have kind of a lot of autonomy on where they purchase their food. And now the state has kind of, I can't remember the word in English, just they've third-partied, outsourced, I guess, the school meal programs to third-party contractors. And even, for example, in this case, this is a community group of women that's managed to get some food service contracts for the schools. They basically are tied up in the industrial food system because they say, well, the industrial food system, the government sometimes doesn't pay us for 3 or 4 months, and so the industrial food system will extend them credit to be able to buy food from their distributors rather than being able to go and buy from the farmers markets or from the local organic co-ops. And so they feel quite, again, squeezed. And I think your slide, Miguel, showing Jandao's squeeze is really relevant here. If you have consumers wanting the local food and you have producers wanting to sell, but you can't, there's no market infrastructure that enables that, that's where I think the social economy really needs to be built up to say, what are the mechanisms of distribution that would be able to level the playing field a little bit on kind of meeting supply and demand for a more locally circular economy. So that's kind of one of the walkaway lessons that we took from Ecuador. There's a lot of initiatives coming from the grassroots that are trying to instill these relationships, but they confront kind of a glass ceiling at the scaling up or distribution level. So both some good news and some kind of things to think about as we go forward. And a lot of those, what's interesting about the farm-to-school case in Ecuador and as I'll show in Brazil, it also resonates with what we're finding with our farm-to-school work in Canada, that you have local farmers who, you know, would love to sell to school programs, but there's just no mechanism right now to do it. Schools are saying, well, we have to buy from Cisco because Cisco has food safety certification and, you know, I can only choose from these limited number of suppliers. So lots of work to do there on the less exciting and less fun nitty-gritty of the food system, but I would say that's where a lot of opportunity lies. So just to kind of close off with an example from Brazil. So again, in Brazil, I work with the Landless Workers Movement, which has done just a pretty inspirational job, I think, of showing how to move from starting a food system from scratch. So a lot of times we think about agroecology and food sovereignty, and we think about, you know, preserving traditional food systems. Well, in Brazil, with the landless workers movement, these are people who've been displaced, sometimes for several generations. And so through the process of land reform and getting access to land, this is often new land for them in a new territory, in a new ecological context. So there's a lot of learning that has to happen. It's not like there's traditional knowledge about this ecology that can kind of be adapted over time. A lot of times you're having to start from scratch with learning a new ecological system, learning how to farm for the first time. Some of these families have lived in the city for one or two or three generations. So it's an incredible kind of opportunity to see, well, how does learning happen in the agroecological context? For how do you start, how do you build a food system from scratch with these principles in mind? And so that's been really kind of amazing to see the different struggles that that has entailed and the failures in many, many cases, but also some really good successes. And one of the ways that they've been able to do that is to keep concentrating on the principles. So this is an example of whenever there's a meeting at the MST, they open with what's called a mystica. It's like basically a little skit, a representation of values or an idea or a poem or a song that kind of starts to create a sense of community and a sense of culture around the idea of food and land. And in this case, they brought in a tree branch and hung from that some values that they wanted to represent. So you have struggle and respect and work and biodiversity and solidarity. And, these are the kind of, even through the school system and through the act of agricultural extension and outreach, you're bringing in these social values into the struggle. So what is that struggle? I work in Mato Grosso in Brazil, which is the soybean capital of the world, where you have an extreme dominance of the international soybean infrastructure. They're bringing in lots and lots of inputs from abroad, and then most of that soybean is going off to Europe and China. So how do you go from that to this? So one of the policy kind of approaches to that has been Brazil's Zero Hunger program, which kind of pulled together some existing agricultural supports in Brazil and added some new ones. So there's always been agricultural credit for small-scale farmers. What Fomezero did is say, well, we're going to attach the terms and the conditions of that agricultural credit to social purposes. So this is kind of starting to come back to that social economy idea. So special credit for new settlers, for women, and for value-added and processing projects. The public procurement program was a guaranteed market for small-scale farmers where you had kind of the right to sell a variety of crops. This one was, the farmers really liked this one because it was flexible. You could, if one crop failed, you could substitute with another. And this food was given to schools, hospitals, and food banks. And then the school lunch program I mentioned earlier was a much bigger market, so you could, the ceiling rate for small-scale farmers was about four times higher than the PAA. This one was, the PAA is what they call a program, so it's subject to cancellation by this new government, but the PNAE, the school lunch program, is not, it's a law. So you see, when you talk about policy change, you know, a program here or there is subject to political manipulation. So legislation can make it more permanent, but then how do you actually work to implement that? We've already talked about land distribution. As another way of kind of thinking about the social economy, you talked about having land be a public good, a social, achieve its social function. And Brazil is a country that has the social function of land as a constitutional provision. So if land is not shown to be achieving its social function, it can be expropriated by the government and redistributed to small-scale farmers. Now, what happens to that land after it's redistributed is a whole other struggle within the MST to keep that land in production, as kind of common land has been a struggle within the movement, even around values over private property. So that's the subject of another talk. But we can talk about how this cultural shift is also required. It's not just a knowledge shift. It's not just an educational project. How do you challenge the fundamental institutions of private property, which, you know, as that property becomes consolidated, then engenders the kind of food system that we have today? So Miguel already talked about the principles of agroecology, and so if we're trying to get agroecology happening on this redistributed land, I'm going to just finish up with one specific project that we did last summer, where we interviewed a number of farmers who are participating in the National School Lunch, the PNA program that I mentioned, to say, well, is that an incentive? Is that kind of incentive to receive a 30% price premium for your agroecological production, is that enough to transition people towards agroecology? So remember, agroecology in this context is new. This is not a traditional kind of set of practices. These are families who either have come through the Green Revolution, and so many of them, that's all they've known, or they've come from the cities and, again, are learning to grow food in this way for the first time. So we were asked, we had a sample of two groups of farmers, one that was certified agroecological and one that was selling to the school lunch program but were conventional farmers. And the idea was to say, well, you know, what is the impact of this policy program on shifting those production practices towards an agroecological production system? Found lots of challenges. So lots of people talked about labor. So this seems to be an initial really big barrier for people to put these systems into place because of the, you know, it may be less work down the road, but farmers, you know, if you can't eat for 5 years while you're waiting for your avocado trees to grow, what is the subsidy or the kind of safety net that would be required to get over that initial labor shortage hump? A lot of people talked about lack of knowledge. There's some kind of deeper epistemological concerns here about people's feeling that they didn't know. They were not feeling their knowledge. They weren't validating their own knowledge. So being told by the outside that you don't know has become internalized to people where they think, well, I need to be following a recipe. And if there is no recipe, that means I don't know. And so trying to kind of dig down into, well, how is knowledge shared and transmitted in an agroecological context, and how do you have to push back against kind of a top-down extension model of knowledge where you want to follow a recipe. A lot of people were concerned about yield reductions. Again, this is, I think, is a discursive challenge. When pressed, very few people actually had experienced a yield reduction. So it was more the fear of having a yield reduction was expressed by a lot of, especially the people who had not converted to agroecological production. They said, well, if I convert, I will have a yield reduction. And so this just, you know, begs for better science and more studies to actually tackle this discursive idea of yield reduction, because in practice this often is shown not to be the case. Access to organic inputs was a big challenge for folks. There's lots of kinds of organic inputs. You can have manure, you can have compost, you can develop these over time. But again, if people didn't have immediate access to them, this was particularly the case in Mato Grosso, where the agricultural input industry is totally dominated by the conventional and industrial food system. And so even the idea of accessing organic seeds was really difficult. Bureaucracy and transaction costs was huge. You know, there's this idea that there's this program out there that you could sign up for and you could get this guaranteed market. Well, it was very difficult to navigate the bureaucracy. A lot of it you had to sign up online. And so if you were a rural person with very spotty 3G access, I mean, people would be going up and standing on their roof to try to submit their school food contract. So just the bureaucracy of the actual infrastructure, not just physical infrastructure, but social infrastructure that was required to have this policy really support an agroecological expansion was pretty significant. So kind of just to conclude, farmers really wanted these price-differentiated markets, which PNAE provides and other local markets do not, so they saw it as an option. This really echoes what we heard in Ecuador, that farmers wanted these specialized markets. They wanted to be able to access these price premiums, but saw a lot of barriers. Certified farmers were more likely to have a higher dependency on the school food. So if we're talking about market diversification, in some cases, they're switching from depending on one kind of market to depending on another. So thinking about how market resilience needs to happen along with ecological resilience was an important learning from this project. And then again, there were just some structural ceilings and limitations. On the positive side, certified farmers showed more network involvement. So even though it may not have made a big difference in their day-to-day of their incomes, these farmers were actually accessing and building an agroecological network in the region that they saw as quite as growing quite quickly. So they said, they were sort of saying things like, if we can get more people into our network, and we can build on this. We can actually not be dependent on the school food program. We can start to be selling in local markets. We can start to set up their own distribution systems. And we did see some farmer-driven distribution systems actually emerging even over the last few years here. So just to my last slide, you know, one of the things we talk about theoretically in rural sociology is this idea of constrained choice. It's not just about choosing the red apple or the green apple. Sometimes there aren't any apples to choose. And why is that? So if you want to look at how policy can support food sovereignty initiatives or how they can support agroecological production systems, we have to think about, well, what are the social and cultural norms that are shaping what consumers are demanding or what producers think they have the ability to provide? What are the ecological processes that are, restricting people's ability to pursue particular production strategies over others? And then, what is their market access and capital access to actually implement some of that infrastructure that we need to build the new food system? So just kind of big picture, does institutionalizing food sovereignty limit its transformative potential? I think there's arguments to be made on both sides, but I think what these initiatives in Brazil and Ecuador have shown is that people are actually looking for solutions. They're demanding that the state support those in certain ways. And I think following that through can be quite interesting to see as we go forward. So thank you.